Oh.
Here we go again. It's a rather dismal day here in the UK. It's a little bit damp, to say the least. Coming up on today's show, we have lots of things, including Mr. Steve talking all about the uses of the word set. And the big question is, will we actually get around to doing it? Also, have you ever made an impulse purchase? Have you ever bought something without thinking too much about it? And have you ever regretted buying something? Also, as I mentioned during the week, we went to a lovely wedding. Yes, and I will be showing you some lovely video clips of that very event. Also, we'll be talking about words connected to getting married. And I will be making a cup of coffee in the kitchen. Yes, I will be showing you how to make a very expensive cup of coffee for just a few pennies. All of that to come today. After all, it is just after 2 o'clock here in the UK. It's a Sunday afternoon, and this is Live English. Oh, hi everybody. How are you today? This is Mr. Duncan in England. Are you okay? I hope so. Are you happy? Oh, I really, really hope you are happy. I hope you are well. And I hope that the sun is shining where you are, because it is still trying to shine here. We have had a very grey morning and a very wet week. We have had so much rain this week. It has absolutely thrown it down. Last week we had water actually building up in the garden. And it's been many years since that happened. So here we go. It is a Sunday. It's the 8th of April already. We are almost halfway through April. So there is a good side and a bad side to that, of course. The good side is that we are a little nearer to summer. But of course, the bad side is that the year is going by so quickly. I can't believe it's already mid-April. The year is going by very quickly. Well, I hope you are okay. I hope you are feeling super duper. It has been very wet this week. Really, really wet. Do you want to see how muddy it is at the moment here? So there I am taking a little walk yesterday through the mud, and look how wet and muddy everywhere is. I was walking through the mud and, needless to say, my boots got very muddy indeed. Very, very muddy, in fact. And of course, you know what happens. Whenever your boots get muddy, you have to do this. I wonder how popular that will become. Will the puddle dance become a very popular craze in 2018? I don't know. I have no idea. I don't know at all. So there I was having a walk in the mud because we have had a lot of rain. In fact, I think it's very fair to say that we have had the wettest winter for many, many years. And at the moment, it is very muddy outside. Would you like to see a live view of the garden?
So we have the camera set up here, and this is a live view. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, I think the sun is trying to come out. So there it is. There is a live view of the garden, and it doesn't look very bright out there, but if you look towards the right hand side of the picture, you can see that there is a lot of water on the ground, and it is so wet. I can't begin to tell you how wet it is at the moment. So there is the view outside. You might in the distance hear the birds. And this morning, guess what I could hear this morning? This morning I could hear the woodpecker pecking away on one of the trees at the back of my house. So the woodpeckers are getting very excited because spring is here and summer is on its way. So this morning I could hear lots of woodpeckers. In fact, if we listen carefully now, you might be able to hear the woodpeckers. Are they there? I'm not sure. Can you hear any woodpeckers out there? Where are the woodpeckers? Of course, they are very shy birds. I sometimes get them in the garden, but not very often because they're very, very shy. Very shy birds, just like me, so shy. Talking of animals in the garden, I've had some very naughty visitors this week to my garden. Yes, needless to say, those naughty visitors are actually squirrels. I think of all the animals that people get in their garden here in the UK, I think the one that causes the most annoyance is the squirrel. Most people hate squirrels. In fact, did you know that here in the UK you can actually shoot or kill squirrels in your garden? They are actually classed as vermin. Vermin. I love that word, vermin. So there is a squirrel squirreling in my garden, and of course squirrels are very naughty creatures. And there is another squirrel raiding one of my bird feeders. Oh, you annoying animal, get off my bird feeder. That isn't for you, that's for the birds. So as you can see, squirrels are very, very annoying, and some people do kill them. Some people poison them, and some people shoot them with air guns because they see them as a nuisance. They see them as an animal that is a pest. I love that word, pest. Pest. If something is a pest, it is very, very annoying. So there is one of the squirrels. Naughty, naughty squirrel, very bad indeed, raiding my bird feeder. But don't worry, there is plenty of food to go around, and of course I don't really mind the squirrels. They're okay, as long as they don't take all of the food from the birds, I will be happy, and so will they. Right, I suppose I should mention the live chat, really, because that is why we are here, to talk about the English language, and lots of people are now on the live chat. Let's have a look. Let's see who is on. First of all, let us say hello to, I think Julie was here today first. Let's have a look. Was Julie first? Yes, Julie G. Hello, you are first on the live chat. Well done to you. The squirrel is so cute, says T.S. Yes, they are cute, but sometimes cute things can be very annoying indeed. Hey, Mr. Duncan, how's your day been so far? I hope you feel good. Analytic brain, I don't feel too bad. Thank you very much. I feel okay. Not too bad. A very busy week. I will be talking all about my busy week a little bit later on, because we have been busy here, Mr. Steve and myself. Sukat says, sometimes We are more of a pest to the world than those animals. It is a pity. Well, I do agree with you, Sue Cat. Sometimes human beings can be very, very nasty. In fact, some people believe that the biggest pest on the planet are human beings. I'm not sure if I agree with that. Hi, Mr. Duncan. Nice to see you. There are many squirrels in the garden. Well, I'm not in London. I'm not actually in London, but maybe you are. I'm not sure, but I don't live in London. I live a long, long way from London. What is the purple blossom in your garden? Asks Mika. The purple blossom you can see is actually heather. Heather. And that particular plant grows all over Shropshire, especially on the very high ground. The very high ground, there is lots of heather everywhere. Huang Nguyen is here. How are you today? I'm okay, thank you very much. I live in a little town which is 40 kilometers westward of Moscow. I think this town is almost the same as Much Wenlock in the UK, says Lena. So maybe you live in a very small place where the population is small as well. And yes, you're right. The place I live in is very small. There are around 5,000 people living here. So in the area I live, there are around about 5,000 people, and I am one of them. Abidullah is here. How am I? How am I? I'm super duper. Thanks for asking. And I hope you are as well. Can I say a very big thank you to all those who have once again made lovely donations on Patreon? You can see your names just behind here. I will hold it up to the camera. So there we go. Can I say a big special thank you to all those who have continued and are continuing to make lovely donations on my Patreon site? Thank you very much. Thank you, Mika. Thank you, Oskri Panova. Thank you to Aziz, Karel, Julie, Tatiana, Andrew, Carmen, Sonichi, Fan, Petra, Anna, Michael, and Oleg. Thank you very much for your lovely donations that I receive every month on Patreon. That's very kind of you indeed. It helps to keep me going. There, you can see all of the names now, I hope. I'm trying my best. There we go. So they will be displayed for the whole of today's live stream. Yes, they will. Live chat is still very busy. Oh, that's strange. YouTube has cut me off. Thank you, YouTube. That's very kind of you. Let's reconnect, shall we? I don't know what's wrong with YouTube this week. They really seem to have made life very difficult for me. I don't know why. Hello, Mr. Duncan. From Belluno. Thank you, Marina, for saying hello, and a big hello to Italy as well. Thank you very much. Tell us when will be the next live stream, asks Antonio. The next live stream will be on Wednesday. In fact, I am here twice a week. It's true. I'm not joking. I actually do 2 live streams each week. Of course, you can see me now on Sunday at 2 p.m. UK time, and on Wednesday at 10 p.m. UK time. So I'm here on Sunday, 2 p.m., Wednesday, 10 p.m. And don't forget, they are both UK time. So I hope that information is helpful to you. So lots of things coming up today. This week, we had the introduction of the sugar tax. And this is something that the government in this country are doing to try and cut down on the amount of sugar that people consume. I'm not sure whether or not it will work. I'm not sure if it will. Maybe it will. But one thing for sure is it will make a lot of tax revenue for the government. So We'll see what happens. That's just started, by the way. Just, I think it was yesterday or Friday. I think it was on Friday that they introduced the sugar tax here in the UK. We have the mystery idioms today. I'm always criticized for never showing the mystery idioms early in the live stream. So today I'm going to break with tradition. I'm going to do it right now. So here are today's mystery idioms. There is the first one, and here is the second one. So they are well-known expressions in the English language. All you have to do is tell me what they are. So there is the first one, today's mystery idioms. And there is the second one. All you have to do is tell me what you see. They are well-known expressions in the English language. In a few moments, I'm going to take you into the kitchen and I'm going to show you how to make an expensive style of coffee. Now, one of the things I really hate about going out is that if you go to have a cup of coffee somewhere, it's so expensive. Even around here, a cup of coffee can cost around about £3 or maybe £4. But if you go to places like London or Manchester, you might find that the coffee will be even more expensive. So if you want a cup of coffee in one of those very posh coffee shops, you know the ones I mean. Yes. I hate paying that much money when I can make it myself for just a few pennies. And that is what I'm going to be showing you in a few moments. We will be going into the kitchen to have a look around. Back to the live chat. I'm from Bangladesh. Your teaching style is unique. Thank you, Thringanam Dio, for your message. It's lovely to hear from you. Rabar H says, you've got to break some eggs. I think that's a guess for the mystery idiom. Thanks for that. Mr. Duncan, are you a coffee person or a tea person? By the way, I hate tea, says Pedro. I sometimes have coffee. For example, today I had a cup of coffee, well, about 2 hours ago, and in a few moments we are going to make a cup of coffee together. I'm going to show you how to make a very expensive cup of coffee for just a few pennies. Mashkur says, hello, how are you? I hope you have a nice day. I have a nice day here. Thank you, Mashkur. I'm very glad to hear that your day is going well. Hello to Pakistan. Muhammad Ali is watching. Hello to you as well. Thanks for joining me on the live chat. Abril says, I love squirrels. They are creatures of nature, just like the birds. Thank you, Abril. I agree with you. Actually, I don't think I could kill squirrels. I don't think I would want to kill squirrels in my garden. So you will be pleased to hear that I never kill squirrels in my garden. Duc Nguyen or Duc Win says, hello from Vietnam. Yes, a big hello to Vietnam. Camel is watching. And a big hello from Nantois in France. Hello to Camel, or should I say bonjour. Thank you, Rosa, for your guess on the mystery idiom. Abhitha says, I know I'm late, but I just got up. Oh, I see. Were you having a lie-in today, or is it still early in the morning where you are? I want to sleep more, but I can't help chatting with Mr. Duncan. Oh, you're in Canada. So yes, I guess it's early morning there. Thank you very much for your message. Nilesh is here. Hello, Mr. Duncan from India. After watching your videos, my English speaking fluency is improving day by day, but I still have some grammatical problems. Well, grammar is something you pick up over time. You can't learn everything at once. You have to have patience and you have to have motivation. So don't give up. Never give up. Simona is here. Hello, Simona. I haven't seen you for a long time. Today we are celebrating Easter here in Romania because it's the Orthodox Easter. Thank you, Simona, for that, and happy Easter to you. Good morning, Mr. Duncan. Josephix is here. Wow, lots of people chatting today. Thanks a lot. Nice to see you all. Mahmoud, you are the best ever. Thank you. Yute, everybody, hello from a sunny day in Germany. Thank you, Yute, for your lovely bright message. And also Nilesh and Fung Dushung, I hope I pronounced your name right. Okay, let's go into the kitchen. We are now going to do something very special. I'm going to make a cup of coffee, but it is no ordinary cup of coffee. It is something very special, something that appears expensive and tastes delicious. You know, I always like to think of myself as a very helpful person. After all, I do like helping you with your English. I also like to help people save money. I'm going to do that right now, here in my magic kitchen. Yes, this is where much of the magic happens when it comes to food, because I love eating food and I also like drinking coffee as well. There is nothing worse than going to a very expensive coffee shop and you have to stand there for ages while they serve you. It takes such a long time and sometimes the coffee is cold by the time you get it. And the worst thing of all is that the coffee costs a lot of money. It's very, very expensive to go to a coffee shop and have one of those skinny lattes or espresso. It's very expensive. If you go to London, can you believe it? In London, a cup of coffee can cost as much as £8 or £9 for one. Yes, one cup of coffee. Today I'm going to show you how to make your very own barista style coffee and it will only cost you a few pennies. Yes, it's true. Here we go. We have everything we need right here. First of all, we have the kettle. So I'm going to boil some water first of all in the kettle. The kettle will boil. And I will also show you what else I have here. So here is my new sachet of coffee. I don't know about you, but I love opening a new sachet of coffee. I really do. I love the smell, the aroma that you get when you open a fresh container of coffee. So that's what I'm going to do first of all. I'm going to open this sachet. That's a great word, sachet. The sachet is a type of container, quite often made of paper or plastic. They are normally soft. They are normally very flexible. So this is a sachet of coffee. So now I'm going to open the sachet and oh my goodness. Oh, that is amazing. There is nothing like the smell, the aroma of a freshly opened container of coffee, I must admit. Oh, do you want to sniff? There we go. Have a little smell of that. It is absolutely delicious. Oh. I can see why coffee can be very addictive because it smells so amazing. So I need to first of all refill this container. So I'm going to refill this container. There we go. So now I have refilled this container and first of all, I will put some coffee in the cups.
And I'm going to show you how to make a very expensive cup of coffee for just a few pennies. Ooh, Mr. Duncan, we are very intrigued. We are very interested in what you are going to show us. So, first of all, I will put some coffee in Mr. Steve's cup because I'm making a cup of coffee for not only myself, but also for Mr. Steve as well, because he's very thirsty. And I will also put 1 teaspoon of coffee, just 1 teaspoon, in my cup as well. So that's the first stage. Then I will put a little bit of sugar in each cup. Now, Mr. Steve likes a little bit of sugar in his coffee. So I will put a little bit of coffee, a little bit of sugar, rather, into Mr. Steve's coffee. And I will put, in my coffee, I have 2 teaspoons. I know, I'm very naughty. A lot of people are going to say, Mr. Duncan, you shouldn't have so much sugar in your coffee. So, that's that. Now, here comes the very interesting part. This is how you can create your own special cup of coffee. So I will put some milk now into each cup. And the reason why I'm putting the milk in first, there is a very special reason for it. And the reason is, as the sun comes out, the reason is I'm going to do something very special with the milk and the coffee that are in these cups. So watch what happens next. In fact, I will put a little bit more milk in, just a little bit more, not too much. And I will show you my special little tool. This is the device that I use for making my expensive coffee. Can you see it? It is a little frothing machine. So this will help the milk to become very frothy. And what you have to actually do is put the hot water into the cups. So you put the hot water into the cups. Don't forget, the water has to be very hot, preferably boiling. So it's better if the actual water is boiling at the time. And what you want to do, you want to heat the milk as quickly as possible. So if you put the boiling water straight onto the milk and coffee, it will create a very special style of coffee. You will have your very own cappuccino. And it won't cost you much money. It's true. So here we go. I will boil the water again. It's very important that the water is boiling. Do, 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 do. So it's very important that the water is boiling. We'll just make sure that it's really, 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 really hot. Okay, and now very quickly we will pour the boiling water onto the coffee. And at the same time, you will use your little machine to froth the coffee. There we go. So now I am making the coffee all frothy. Ooh. So there it is. I will do that for a few moments. And look, look what we have here. Yes, it's incredible. Look at that. So now we have a very expensive style of coffee. So this now looks just like the sort of coffee that you would get in a very expensive coffee shop in London or Italy. So there we go, a lovely frothy coffee. And now I will do mine. So this is Mr. Steve's,
And now I will do mine. And don't forget, it's very important that the water is very, very hot. So you make the water as hot as possible, like this. Another good thing you can do, you can also pour the water from a great height. So if you pour the water from very high up, it creates even more friction in the milk. So I will show you what I mean. I will show you what I mean by that. Here we go again. Don't forget, you need this device as well, a little coffee frother. Right, let's go. Yeah! And there you have it. Look at that. That is absolutely perfect. So if you went to a coffee shop, if you ordered this at a coffee shop, this would cost you about £5 or £6, or maybe even £8 or £9 if you bought this in London. And here I am in my kitchen making a very expensive cup of coffee for just a few pence. Isn't that amazing? And there it is. Done and done. So let me just show you. So now we have 2 cups of very expensive coffee. So if you went to a coffee shop, this would cost you about £5 or £6. And here I am in my kitchen making it for just a few pennies. And those few pennies, of course, relate to the electricity that I used to boil the water. And that's it. So I will take this cup of coffee up to Mr. Steve, and you will rejoin me live in the studio, because it is a Sunday afternoon and this is Live English.
It is Live English, as it's said there on the screen, and it's Sunday afternoon. It's Mr. Duncan, that's me, live on YouTube across the world. I hope you are happy on this Sunday afternoon. It's afternoon here in the UK. Maybe it's morning where you are, or maybe it is evening. It might even be tomorrow where you are. Coming up, don't forget, at 3 o'clock, yes, he is here at 3. It is the man who has a lot of followers now, apparently, on YouTube. I get the feeling that there are many people now tuning in to my live stream just to watch this guy. He's coming up at 3 o'clock, and we went to a wedding this week. We had a lovely, lovely time. In fact, we enjoyed it so much, we can honestly say that it might have been the best wedding that we've ever been to, especially afterwards, because we had some absolutely gorgeous food. If you look very closely, you can see the actual card that was on the table in front of me. And there you can see, if I turn it round, you can see on the back, there is a list of the things that I ate. So I had some soup, I had some beef, and I had lemon tart. I don't know about you, but I really do like a little bit of tart now and again. You can't beat it. Live chat is very busy. Lots of people were talking about the coffee today. Yes, coffee can be very expensive in places like London. £7, £8, or even £9 for a cup of coffee. Can you believe it? Abhishek says, it is evening here. I think maybe you are in Asia. I'm not sure. One for me, please, says Tias. Oh, do you want a cup of coffee? I think so. So the little thing I was using is called a coffee frother. It makes your coffee frothy. And of course, the secret is to get the milk very hot as well. It is very, very simple. It's a very simple device. I'm trying to think how much it cost. I think it was only £10. So for the same price as a cup of coffee, you can have one of those lovely little devices and it will make your coffee very frothy, just like one of those expensive coffees that you get in one of those coffee shops. With all due respect, oh dear, when people say that, you know that something bad is going to be said. Tomek says, with all due respect, did you just make instant coffee and compare it with a cup of coffee from a coffee shop? Seriously? Yes, of course I'm serious. It tastes just as good. The secret, of course, is to heat the milk up. That's the secret. So by pouring the very hot water onto the milk, you heat the milk up just like they do in a coffee shop. Now, of course, you have to buy very good quality coffee as well. So the coffee that I've got is very, very good. Very good quality. And guess where it comes from? Can you guess where it comes from? Where the coffee comes from? Yes, the coffee that I like drinking comes from Brazil. I said Brazil. I like my coffee black, says Mika. Now, to be honest, I must admit, I do like a little bit of milk, or sometimes I have cream in my coffee if I'm feeling very adventurous. But the one thing I do like is a little bit of sugar. I can't drink coffee on its own. I find it very bitter. I find the flavour very bitter, very sour. Would you like to have another look at the mystery idioms? Of course you would. Yes, there they are. The first mystery idiom, a well-known phrase in the English language, and there is the second one. These are well-known expressions used in English all the time. And there they are. So it's a lovely day here. I think the sun is starting to come through, even though the sky still looks very dark. But I think the sun is trying to get through. So there it is, a live view outside at the moment. Yes, it's definitely live. Don't you believe me? Don't you believe that that's live? Okay then, but it is. It's definitely live. And I can prove it. So, I hope you are enjoying the weather where you are. It's been very wet, very muddy, and I must admit, I found the weather to be quite unpleasant over the past few days. Coming up today, we have lots of questions. Would you say that sometime in your past you have ever made an impulse purchase? A purchase. So purchase means to buy. If you buy something, you purchase it. And the word impulse means to do something with little thought. You do it almost like a reflex. You do it without thinking very much. So, have you ever made an impulse purchase? Something that you've bought without putting much thought into it. Now, one of the things that Mr. Steve and myself enjoy doing, especially on a Saturday night, we like to sit and watch one particular channel on our television, and that is the shopping channel. There is a great shopping channel, and there is one man who we love watching because he is very, very funny. His name is Peter Simon, and I'm sure you can look him up on the internet or on YouTube. There are lots of video clips on YouTube featuring this guy, and he's very funny, very entertaining. But over the past few times that we've watched this channel, Steve and also myself, we have felt as if we want to buy something. We felt very tempted to buy something. So that is what I'm talking about today. So have you ever made an impulse purchase? Have you ever bought anything that you didn't think about much? Also, the thing sometimes can be very expensive. So it might be something that's very expensive, something you've bought and it's a very expensive item. And sometimes you can regret buying something. So you might buy it in a hurry, and then later you think, oh, why did I buy that? Why did I buy that thing? I really regret buying it. So have you ever made an impulse purchase? Nowadays, it is so easy to buy things. Very easy. You can just go on the internet and you can find the thing that you want, and you can click, pay for it straight away. And normally it comes the next day or maybe 2 days later. So here in the UK, this is the most amazing thing of all. I must admit, I find this incredible that nowadays you can search for something on the internet. You can choose it. You can click. You can pay for it. And then the next day it arrives at your front door. It's actually there in your hand. It's incredible. So I suppose nowadays it's very tempting to buy things on impulse. So there it is again, the word impulse. Impulse and purchase. Together they make an impulse purchase. Of course, sometimes you buy things that you are very pleased with, such as my little machine for making my coffee go all frothy. I must admit, I really enjoy using that very much, as you could see earlier. Mr. Steve will be here in 12 minutes. I've got an itchy nose, excuse me. Oh, I feel as if I'm going to sneeze. I think it's Mr. Steve, because this week Steve has been off and he's been cleaning the garage. He's been making lots of dust. So at the moment there's a lot of dust floating around outside, and I think it's because Mr. Steve has been sweeping the garage, making lots and lots of dust. Let's have a look then. Yes, I have an impulse purchase and I bought some expensive cosmetics, says Rosa. Well, I do know that you ladies, you women, you love buying your cosmetics. You really do. Mr. Duncan, I'm so happy to watch your stream today. It's me, Peter, from Brazil, the policeman. Thank you. And I promise to stay well behaved today. I will be on my best behavior. So don't worry, Peter. I am always a good boy. T.S., I regretted buying a cell phone. I was panicking because my old phone was broken, so I bought a new one immediately and spent all my savings. Then my old phone started working again. It was an impulse. Yes, so you bought the phone without thinking too much. But of course, one of the things that can happen when you panic, you can also stop thinking in a rational way. So sometimes when you panic, you do things that you wouldn't normally do. And that is one of the problems with impulse buying. You buy things without thinking. You don't put much thought into it. Pierre says, I'm Irene and I had a pelvis fracture. And I was in hospital for 6 weeks. It was a terrible moment. I'm so glad to see you again. Thank you, Irene. I'm so sad to hear that you had an accident. What happened? Did you fall over? Did you slip over? Was it in the snow, maybe? Did you fall in the snow? So I'm glad to hear that you are on the mend, but 6 weeks in hospital, that's a very long time. But I hope you are now on the road to recovery. Jamelia is here. I hope that your nose problem isn't hay fever. It's a bit too early at the moment for hay fever. So at the moment, no, I don't think it is hay fever. I think it's Mr. Steve. He's been sweeping up and making lots and lots of dust. Shira Blade says, oh, Mr. Duncan, you are very funny. I don't miss your lessons, or I haven't missed your lessons since 2010. So you've been watching me for 8 years. Thank you, Shira Blade. That's very kind of you indeed. Wow. Thank you very much. Did I misspell coffee today? Well, that's probably because I wrote it very quickly. I probably missed out the second E or the second F. But that was because I was rushing. Mr. Duncan, me too. I like internet shopping. Things are very attractive. And afterwards, I regret and understand that there was no need to buy all of those things. Yes, sometimes we buy things and then later we regret it. You do something without thinking and then later, when you have lots of time to think, you regret it. So a little bit later on, we'll be looking at one of Mr. Steve's impulse buys, something that Mr. Steve bought in a hurry. And then later he regretted it. But what will it be? Olga says, today I was shopping with my husband and I wanted to buy several things on impulse. And my husband stopped me. He said, maybe we will find something better later. And now I regret that I listened to him. Oh, I see. So you regret listening to your husband. Oh, dear me. I'm not saying anything to that. I will not make any comment whatsoever. But sometimes it is better to think about what you are going to buy before you buy it. Tomek says, once I made an impulse purchase, I fell into the trap of a shop clerk or clerk. Actually, it was for her cleavage. I think Tomek was very distracted by the very attractive sales assistant. That's what I think happened there. Ersan says, it doesn't matter. You don't have to miss out sipping the coffee. Oh, okay. We're talking about coffee again, are we? Well, I like coffee. Not all the time. I don't think that I'm addicted to coffee. But now and again, I do like a little cup of coffee. It's much better to make your own coffee at home. Of course, some people buy those very expensive machines, don't they? And sometimes they can cost maybe £400 or £500 for a coffee machine. So you put the coffee beans in the top and then the machine will grind the coffee and then it will make the coffee for you. So yes, I suppose that the coffee from that machine would taste very nice. But once again, you have to spend a lot of money. And that's another thing I nearly bought. 2 or 3 years ago, I nearly bought a coffee machine off the internet. But then I thought, do I really need to spend £300 or £400 on a coffee machine? And guess what? I changed my mind and I didn't buy one. So that's the reason why I make my my coffee cheaply. Some people say it's not the same, but sometimes it tastes very delicious, to be honest. Giuseppe says, I once bought a pair of shoes and it was an impulse buy. I've never worn them. Yes, that's what happens, especially clothes. See, I think women sometimes do this. I think women sometimes buy clothes and then they put them in the wardrobe and they never wear them. It's just something to make them feel happy. So yes, I think it happens sometimes. Jamelia says, I am an impulse buyer, especially when it comes to clothes. Yes, I can see. I can see your little emojis. I can see a dress and a shirt or a blouse. And then I can see a t-shirt, a pair of jeans, and also a pair of shoes as well. Yes. I think it would be fair to say that women do enjoy buying clothes. And maybe sometimes those purchases are impulse purchases. Maybe they are done on impulse, something that you buy without thinking carefully about. See, I always believe that sometimes it is best to walk away and then think about it. We call this cooling off. So you cool off. You think twice about something. You consider it very carefully. So you see something that you want to buy and then you think carefully about it. You think, do I really need that? Like my coffee making machine. I decided not to buy it in the end because it was very expensive. So I had time to cool off. Back to the live chat, because it would appear that a lot of people want to talk about this. I agree with you, Mr. Duncan. To regret that you didn't buy something is much worse. Oh, really? Oh, okay then. So maybe, yes, maybe regretting not buying something can be just as bad as buying something you don't want. Gosia says, I love buying handbags. I love buying handbags. Yes, because that's what ladies like to do. You like to buy handbags. Mr. Steve's sister loves handbags very much. I think it would be fair to say she likes handbags very much, especially the very expensive ones. Yes, indeed. Patty says, I'm a shopaholic. A shopaholic is a person who likes shopping. In fact, they can't stop doing it because they like it so much. So, Patty, you are a shopaholic. You like to shop until you drop. Thank you very much for that. Yes, to cool off. If you cool off, it means you give yourself time to consider something carefully. You cool off. I am from Belgium and I learn English from you. Your best videos. Thank you, Mashkor, for that. You are very welcome. A lot of people have asked, Mr. Duncan, how can we get in touch with you? How can we contact you on YouTube and through the internet? Well, for those who are wondering how you can contact me, here are my contact details. So now there is no excuse. You have my email address. You have my Facebook address. You can contact me through those and follow me as well. I have lots of followers on Facebook, and you are more than welcome to join me. You can follow as well if you want to. A quick look at the live chat, and then Mr. Steve will be here. I just realized that I didn't close the microphone outside, so I think you could probably hear all of the sounds of the garden. I just realized. I hope it wasn't too annoying. Mr. Duncan, we reply to your emails, definitely. Yes, I will reply to the emails. I can't reply to all of them, though. That is something I never promise, but I do try to reply when I can. I love buying scented candles and little bottles of different kinds of scented oils to put in little ovens with little candles. Beautiful aromas make me feel at home. Dear Mr. Duncan, thanks for helping my husband improve his English. I am trying my best as an English teacher, but you are the one who does it. I assume that's what you were going to say. Thank you, Laura, for that. Valentine says, if I can get it onto the screen, when my computer didn't work, I was trying to fix the issue myself. Before I eventually made a mistake, I bought a motherboard, but the problem was with a video card. Oh, I see. So you thought it was a problem with the motherboard, but it was a different problem altogether. Okay. I like to buy beautiful notebooks, says M. Seska Asmo. Sometimes I like to buy pens, but these days, Mr. Steve has lots of free pens, so I do tend to use his. Talking of Mr. Steve. Oh, apparently, according to Julie G, apparently I am now on Wikipedia on the Much Wenlock page. Oh, I wonder if someone's put me on there. Oh, I wonder. Ooh, that's nice. Hello, Mr. Duncan from Adriana. Thank you very much for that. Here he comes. Mr. Steve is on his way. Dibby dibby dip 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 do 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 do. Yes, we are live on YouTube, and it's just after 3 o'clock on a Sunday afternoon here in the UK. Don't forget, I'm here every Sunday from 2 p.m. and late and live on Wednesday from 10 p.m. Both of those UK time, as you can see right over there. The details are on the screen right now. So here we go. It's Mr. Steve, the man whose face can launch 1,000 ships. 1,000! Can you believe it? Here he is.
Hello. Launch 1,000 ships, more like sink 1,000.
Yes. Maybe. Now, Mr. Steve, you are looking very lovely today. I must admit, you are looking very bright, very fresh. Yes, your skin looks like you've done something to it. You look very fresh today.
As the expression goes, I scrub up well.
So Mr. Steve, when Mr. Steve cleans himself, when he has a wash and a shower, he cleans up very well. He scrubs up well. I think that would be fair to say.
Yes, you often use that expression if somebody comes into the room, you haven't seen them for a while, and maybe they were looking a bit disheveled, unshaven, their hair wasn't right. Then they go into the bathroom, freshen themselves up, put a bit of makeup on, comb their hair, and then you say, oh, you scrub up well,
you clean up very well. So when you take time to take care of your appearance, you look very good. So yes, you're looking pretty good today. I like that shirt, by the way.
Oh, this old thing. I just threw it on.
It looks a little bit, now I'm not being personal here, Steve, does look a little bit like it does look a little bit like a tablecloth.
I hope you don't come and eat on me.
No, I won't be eating
or lay cutlery over me.
I won't be doing anything like that, so don't worry. So live chat is busy, lots of people want to say hello to Mr. Steve. Let's just see what is going on. Hey Mr. Steve, how are you, says Adriana. Yes,
lip
Mr.
gloss.
Sorry.
Psyche says I've got lip gloss on. I haven't got lip gloss on, I can assure you of that.
Mr. Steve never wears lip gloss.
I have not got any lip gloss on.
He doesn't wear lip gloss.
It's not lip gloss. I've got something that the air is very dry and my lips crack. So I've actually put some, it's like a chapstick, it's called, for chap lips.
I
might have put some of that on earlier. So maybe that's still there, but it's not lip gloss. It's so that when I smile, my lips don't crack and bleed.
Yes.
Chapstick, it's called. C-H-A-P, stick. You can buy them from chemists when you've got dry lips. So I put some of that on this morning outside. So yeah, I was looking at the live chat before we came on because you were talking about impulse buys. And I think people were getting quite excited talking about what they like to buy and purchase. Materialism. Many of us living in the West, Western culture, are very susceptible to purchasing lots of things.
I don't think it's even the West now. I think because people can buy things all around the world and they can be flown. You can even buy things from another country. So in the past, I've purchased things from the USA or even Japan. So I bought a couple of DVDs from Japan of some Japanese animation, and you could only get it from Japan. So I ordered that from there, and it was like 4 or 5 days. 5 days later, it was in my hand. It was incredible. So I do love that ease now. It's so easy. So I think many people now find it very convenient. But the problem is, Steve, and we all know the problem, sometimes you can purchase something and then later you regret it. We call this
impulse purchase or an impulse buy. Yes, we're all susceptible to that. And this is something I'm the sort of person that likes to recycle and use things. I don't like to replace anything until it literally wears out.
Yes.
I always bitterly regret buying things when I've already got something that works. And whereas other people, I won't name any names, I don't mean you, certain members of my family, like to throw things out and replace them constantly. Whereas, for example, I'm still using, when my grandparents died, which is 30 years ago now, 30 years ago, I had a lot of their stuff from their house, all their cutlery, plates, things like that. And I still use a lot of their plates because I can't bear to throw them out. I hate throwing out old things. And that's what I've been doing. I heard you mention that I've been into the garage clearing things out, because when we moved, there's a lot of stuff in there that hasn't been sorted out. So, for example, an old dining table and chairs, which were my grandparents, which are probably over 100 years old. They're not expensive. It's not expensive furniture, but I can't bear to throw it out. So I've been sanding these old chairs down and varnishing them and trying to make them look good again, because I want to use them. I don't really need them, but I can't bear to throw them out. I'm trying to think of ways I can use them around the house.
Do you think, Steve, maybe there's a bit of sentimentality there? Maybe you're feeling a little bit sentimental as well, because those chairs represent something from your past, so you don't want to throw them away because you feel very emotional towards them. They have what we call sentimental value.
Well, they do a bit, but I just can't bear to throw anything out that is still in working order, that is still working. So unless it's broken, I don't throw it out. I'm a little bit of a hoarder. I do tend to keep things because I always think, oh, I might need that one day. And in fact, I've done it this week already. I've been keeping bits of wood for years in the garage. Long pieces of wood, batons we call them, long pieces of wood. And I burnt them all the other day. And guess what? Today I went in the garage and I thought, oh, I could have used that piece of wood to hang up on the wall, put some hooks on it and put all my tools on. But yes. I've burnt it.
Oh, yes.
I've been keeping it for years, so I'm really annoyed. Annoyed today.
The really ironic thing about that is that you asked me if I needed them.
I know. This is it. I like to keep everything because you never know when you want it. The problem is, of course, you keep everything. When you want it, you can't find it.
Yeah.
So you go searching high and low for it. You can't find it. So you go out and buy it. And then about 2 months later, you find it somewhere.
And then the other problem, of course, is you end up like one of those people on those TV shows, those reality TV shows that live in their house. And everything is piled around them. They have newspapers and magazines and all of their dirty underwear. And their bathtub is now brown with slime and everything's up to here. They talk to you over a big pile of newspapers. So you can become too obsessed with keeping things. You can become a hoarder.
You can. That's when it goes too far.
Mm.
When you literally can't throw anything out, even things like if you've had a pizza delivered, you can't even bear to throw out the box that the pizza came in, or any wrapping of anything that you've ever bought. So if you buy some fruit and they're in some kind of plastic container, some people will even keep that.
Mm.
And in fact, we know somebody like that.
Oh, steady.
Don't worry, I'm not going to say who. yes, it's a real problem for some people.
Yeah, it's not me, by the way.
No, it's not you. It's somebody. Let's just say a neighbor. Could be next door, could be several doors away. Yeah, we're not going to say
Steve,
who
Steve,
or what.
Steve, you know, sometimes in life, it is better to stay quiet about certain things. And even when you give hints.
Are you telling me to be quiet, Mr. Duncan?
Well, I'm just telling you to stop talking about that particular subject.
Let's just call her. No, I'm not kidding. A certain person, let's just call them. No, we're not going to say that because we might get ourselves into trouble.
What are you doing? Are you trying to get us libeled?
No, I haven't said the name.
I know, but anyway,
let's move on. Yeah. We went to a lovely wedding, didn't we? Oh, do you still want to talk about impulse buys?
Well, I'm going to show something now that you bought as an impulse buy.
What?
And now it's something that you don't use anymore. Do you remember, Mr. Steve, do you remember when you bought this particular item, this thing that you bought, and you said
you've got it here,
you said, I really need it, and now it sits alone gathering dust, never to be used.
What is it, Mr. Duncan?
I'm building up to it.
It's a long build up.
That's okay, don't worry. So something now that's sitting in the garage gathering.
I think I know what it is.
Can I just finish this? Gathering dust, lonely,
unused, unloved.
I'm going to come over there and smack you in a minute.
Get on with it.
Yes, I'm trying to build up to it. I'm building up to it, Steve. It's called suspense. Sitting alone in the garage gathering dust. Neglected. And a great big waste of money.
Oh, yes.
Oh.
What's it called? I can't remember what it's called now.
It's a turbo spray.
It's one of those patio cleaners.
Well, it's not just for patios. You can use it for all. It's a multi-purpose power spray.
It's a power washer. Yeah. Yes. Now, I thought, I thought I'd really wanted one of those because, let's face it, when we moved here, there's like a patio at the back of the house, and it was covered in moss and mold and dirt, and the drive was dirty as well. And I thought, oh, I'll buy one of these, I'll be able to clean it all up, and I can use it for washing the car as well. Well, I did use it once, but really the trouble with those, yes, so it wasn't really an impulse buy. I really thought I needed it, but which is slightly different than when I got it, I realized very rapidly, and it was quite expensive,
yes,
that in fact I didn't really need it at all.
That's it.
And I could have done without it.
Well, I think this particular thing is, this particular device is something that actually does more than it should, because if you use it in certain situations on your driveway or on your concrete or on your beautiful prize block paving, it can actually destroy it.
Yes, they actually cause a lot of damage.
So because they work so well, because the jet of water that comes out is so powerful, most people get very carried away and they put it on full power because they think that's better. But what they end up doing is damaging their garden. They damage the concrete or the pavements or the path or the driveway. So they end up destroying all of these things by using this particular machine in the wrong way. So I think this has its uses, but most people use it in the wrong way. And of course, you can use this for cleaning your car as well. But again, you have to be very careful. You could end up damaging your car.
Yes, it's too powerful, really. What I ended up doing is that you start spraying it around. Yes, it takes all the moss off, but then in between the tiles where all the cement is or the grouting, it takes that all out as well. And I started using it on the drive, and it started taking the bits of the, you know, all the grit and everything was flying everywhere.
Well,
and it's not very good at washing the car because it doesn't get, you still got to scrub it anyway,
yes,
to get the dirt off, and you can't use it near the on the wheels because if you go near the tires, it damages the rubber on the tires. So in fact, it was a complete waste of money. I haven't used it for 4 years. Yes, I ought to sell it.
You could sell it on eBay.
Well, there we go. There's something I tried to get into, eBay. But of course, I got all mixed up with how to sign up for that. And then it's all very, you know, I just thought, well, if anybody buys it, I'm gonna have to pack it and post it off. Oh, that was too much hassle. So I had a lot of stuff in the garage, which I'd gathered together, thinking I could make a bit of money out of this. And in the end, I just took it to the charity shop.
It's more trouble.
It was a lot easier.
It's more trouble than it's worth. I'm always amazed at these people who sell things on eBay, and they do it all the time. They get really excited. Oh, I've got some books here. I'm going to sell them on eBay. Oh, I've got this. I'm going to sell it on eBay. And I think, oh, it's such a lot of hassle.
Some people do make a living from eBay because they buy things off eBay very cheaply because they time it just right with the auction. So they get something very cheap and then they keep all this stuff and then they resell it. And if they can resell it at a higher price than they bought it at, they've made a profit. And some people do, in fact, run little businesses from home like this, and they're just recycling all the stuff on eBay. It's not their own stuff. They're buying stuff. That's the trick, apparently, is buying something cheap off eBay and then reselling it at a higher price. Or buying something, then cleaning it up and then reselling it. So I think you ought to do that, Mr. Duncan.
What's that?
Generate some extra income. Go onto eBay and just start a little business.
I have nothing to sell.
No, that's what I mean. You just buy things off eBay.
No.
On auction. You don't want it. And then you get it a lot. You think, well, I've got that quite cheap, and I can resell it at double the price.
That doesn't make any sense.
People do that. That's how they make a living, out of eBay, apparently.
So, wait there. But you've got to buy the things to start with. So you buy things, and then you sell them again?
Yeah.
On eBay?
Yeah. That's what people do.
But they were already on eBay for sale.
Yes, I know. But the trick is that because it's an auction, isn't it, on eBay?
Yeah. Well, not always. I mean,
not
nowadays.
Not always. But no, if you... Listen to me, Mr. Duncan.
No, you listen to me.
I'm telling you how people make a living out of eBay. They get something cheaply.
Yes.
Say, I don't know, say a CD.
What a waste of time.
Well, I know, but it's up to them if they want to do it. I'm not saying I want to do it. Some people might want to do it, and some people do it. Like a CD. Say they get it for £2 off eBay, but then they try reselling it at £5. Okay. So they make a little profit because somebody might just buy it. Apparently, that's how it works. Oh. Somebody out there is doing it and can tell us.
They have nothing else to do with their life.
Well, I don't know, but some people are apparently running little businesses like that. So good for them.
Well, the part that really annoys me is the part where you have to keep packing and sending things and posting things. Oh,
well, yes, you've got to be prepared to do that, of course.
That would drive me crazy. But yes, as I mentioned earlier, we Mr. Steve did make a very foolish purchase. We can safely say that is definitely an impulse purchase. Would you say?
Sort of.
Yes.
But sort of.
It's now something Mr. Steve no longer uses. It just sits in the garage.
I might use it on you.
All alone, gathering dust.
I might use it on you, Mr. Duncan.
Look at it. It's so sad, and it even looks sad.
It looks fine.
It looks like a sad person sitting in the corner
probably
of the room.
Doesn't work now. It's probably rusted away. All the insides are probably rusted.
Yes, I doubt it even works now.
Is anybody saying anything on the live chat?
I don't know. I'm not psychic. No, they're not saying anything. Because YouTube
cut them off.
YouTube has disconnected me again. I don't know what's going on with YouTube. YouTube doesn't like me anymore. they actually dumped me this week. Isn't that nice? I got a message from YouTube saying, oh, Mr. Duncan, we're dumping you. Isn't that nice? I just love that. Thanks, YouTube, for that. Thanks really a lot. Thanks for that. Olga, when I moved to my current home, I sold a lot of stuff on eBay, like an internet shop. I did it for a small amount of money. I just didn't want to throw things away. So, Olga, you sold them so they would be useful to another person. Oh, that's okay. I think that's very good.
Yes that's what I think. I don't like to throw something away if it's working. But then sometimes it's a hassle to get rid of it, to sell it to somebody. So I just gave a lot of stuff away to the charity shop. There's one in Much Wenlock that they use all the money to help injured animals.
Yes, that's a charity shop. Yes, I agree with that. That's a good idea.
Because, I mean, let's face it, a lot of the stuff I had in the garage, I wasn't going to make that much out of it. Maybe I might have made £50. You know, and the hassle of dealing, it would have taken me weeks to sell it all. But I've got a lot of car magazines that I wish to offload, to get rid of. You see, I can't even bear to throw those away because I don't think they're worth much, but at the same time, somebody might find them useful. They might want to read them. Some of them date back to sort of early 1970s.
So you've got some old car magazines. Maybe you could set up a market stall here on the live chat. Maybe you could have a market stall. Does anyone out there want to buy any old car magazines? They're all in good condition, but they're just very old car magazines.
Motorsport.
So all of the magazines are about cars that no longer exist. if that's your thing.
I've got loads of them. I've got probably about 100 old car magazines from the 1970s and 1980s.
Yeah.
Which I will probably never read again.
But of course, imagine shipping those.
I know.
They weigh about 5 ton. There is you can't even lift the boxes. The boxes that the magazines are in, you can't lift them up. You give yourself a hernia.
Collect only.
So I doubt that anyone today is going to buy those because most people are watching in other countries, you see, around the world.
I discovered as well that a lot of these magazines are, in fact, they've already been sort of scanned and put onto the internet anyway. So you can look at any of the content of these magazines.
Yes.
Going back, some of the ones I thought I could sell. they're now available on the internet in some kind of they've been scanned anyway.
Yeah, so they just take the back issues and scan them, and then you can read them without paying anything.
Yes, or pay a small subscription sometimes for some of these sites. But sometimes the physical copy, I'm sure there's a market out there. So maybe I'll hold on to them for another 20 years.
Yeah, what you need to hold on to them until all magazines have gone. So every magazine that exists on the planet has been destroyed, and you've still got a box of magazines, the only magazines left in existence, and they'll be worth millions.
I'll tell you something that I was very surprised about. I'd got a set of old encyclopedias which belonged to my grandfather, so they must be 100 years old probably.
No one wanted those,
and not even the second-hand bookshop wanted them. They were, you know, they were in quite good condition, about 12 volumes, encyclopedias, and they said we can't even sell any encyclopedias because everybody Googles everything now.
Yes, they just use the internet,
and they're not even interested in what encyclopedias, the content of encyclopedias 100 years ago, which I suppose nobody would be. But I thought somebody might just like to flick through them just out of interest.
Yeah, but the other problem is those particular books that you just mentioned, they're in terrible condition.
They're not too bad, but I thought I was just going to give them away for nothing, but they wouldn't even take them for nothing.
They look like they were found on a rubbish tip.
I'll have to burn them, I think. I don't like to burn books, but I think I'll have to burn them.
Well, next winter we can use them as kindling on the fire.
Well, each one must be equivalent to a log in terms of its energy content, so yeah. I'll stack them up.
I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll get each encyclopedia and we'll burn them in alphabetical order. So we'll start by burning Aardvark, and then we'll finish by burning, I want to say, Zoo. So we'll burn every page in your encyclopedias, but we'll do it in alphabetical order.
Well, we could do. There's 12 of them anyway.
Sounds good to me.
I'd love to look at all the scientific information in there and see how out of date that is.
We went to a wedding, Steve.
We went to a wedding.
Would you like to see some little clips from our wedding? Not our wedding.
Well, you'd think so.
Not our wedding. It wasn't our wedding. Mr. Steve and myself, we were not getting married last week. But here...
Despite your thumbnail...
Yes,
suggesting that we might have been.
Do you like the thumbnail for my lesson today? I thought that was really funny. It was making me laugh so much yesterday because, of course, I'm the bride and Mr. Steve is the groom. And on the photograph, I don't look very happy. So here we go. Last week. Which day was it? What
Thursday.
Was it?
It was Thursday just gone.
Thursday last week. We went to a wedding and they're outside the church. And there's Mr. Steve. He's going over to join the choir because he was actually singing. You were singing, weren't you, Steve?
I was. I was asked. It was just like a sort of, about 8 of us were asked if we would sing in the church for the wedding.
Oh, look.
And, there's the bride and bridegroom.
Oh. And it was quite a nice church, a very small church. It was one of these small local churches.
Yes.
But yes, quite a nice building. And you can see there, and there outside, the bride and groom are leaving. They are about to go off. Oh, look, a little emotional moment there. The names are, what are their names?
Emma, that's Emma.
Yeah. That's Emma.
And John is her husband.
That's
a very fancy car that they went off in afterwards.
Her new husband, yes. They are now married.
And that's the reception afterwards. Yes. It was a beautiful day.
Oh, it was a gorgeous day, wasn't it? And there is a place that we went to called Weston Hall. It's actually in Stafford, the place in which I was raised. And there you can see the bride and groom having their photographs taken. And this place in particular was gorgeous. It was a lovely place, not far from where I was raised.
Oh, exactly. Yes. There's a little garden, well, ornament. It's a bit too big for an ornament.
It's like an arboretum.
Yes, there is a name for that, I'm sure.
And there you can see, looking over towards the road. that particular road, by the way, is well known in Stafford for being very busy. It's the Western Road. It's very busy. There's always lots of cars and lorries driving along. And look, there's the lovely wedding cake. And there I am with a special good luck charm. Good luck.
Looking very smart, Mr. Duncan.
And there's Mr. Steve.
There I am in my wedding attire. I think purple or pink is always a good decision to make if you're going to a wedding for a man. It's very easy for a man, of course. You just got to put a suit on and a tie.
It's a very good choice of color. I don't know why, for weddings you normally find very, very loud colors on men look better. So normally the suits are light, maybe a gray color. Sometimes the shirts are white or maybe purple or pink. So quite often everything is very, very colourful, because of course it's a very special day, isn't it? Would you like to see us? I've got some footage here of the reception. So there it is. So the reception, we sat down and we had a lovely meal. So the reception normally comes much later, doesn't it?
Yes, after the bride and bridegroom come out of the church, about an hour later everybody drives off for the reception. And there's a pretty grand, smart-looking room, and there are many of all the guests that came to the wedding, and we're all about to sit down. We've all had named places, and we're all about to sit down and have what turned out to be a lovely meal.
It was,
and in fact, this was one of the nicest weddings I think I've ever been to.
We both agreed on this, didn't we? The service was quite nice. The reception was absolutely amazing. It was gorgeous. The food was incredible.
All the people were very friendly, lovely people, and it was just. And in fact, the story, it was a happy ending, really, because John and Emma have known each other for many, many years. Probably I think they've known each other for about 20 years.
Wow, that's a very long time to know each other.
Probably more than that.
Very long time.
I think more like 25 years I think they'd known each other, and they used to go out together and see each other, and then they split up, and then about 13 years later they got back together again, and now they're married. So happy ending for both of them.
I like a happy ending.
Yes, it was lovely. And I've got some words and phrases. Of course, it's spring. People start thinking about sort of marriage and dating, don't they, in the spring.
Look,
just like
that.
The animals are all looking for new mates. Then people start to get a bit frisky and start thinking about finding a partner. That's a traditional time of the year, isn't it, to try and find a partner.
That's it. I think we get that bit. So that there it is. Look, so just to prove that everything is looking very spring-like, there is a live shot of the garden. There it is, live view. If we have time, we might pop outside a little bit later and do a little bit outside. We'll see what happens. But there it is. It's a little dull, quite dull today.
Now, that's a live shot. It is.
It is a live shot, yes.
Wow.
That is definitely live. And maybe later we will go outside as well. But for the time being, we have something important to do. You have some words and sentences connected with being married or getting married or planning to get married.
I do. I've got them on my little pieces of paper here. And I've also got a copy of the marriage order of service that was given out to everybody when they arrived, so we can have a quick look at that, and we can look at things that are said, procedures that happen in a wedding in the UK, and also quite similar to the America as well. So let's start off. I thought I'd do this in a kind of an order. So when two people meet and they like each other, we start off with courtship. Do we not? Courtship.
So to court is to... Would you say that that's very similar to dating?
Dating, yes. Well, yes, it, I suppose it is. Well, dating is when you're just seeing lots of different people. Oh. Or you might date one person, but that is just... Well, courtship is like a period of time. So you've maybe dated a number of people, and then you've decided that you want to see this particular person for a longer period of time, and you think, oh, there could be something there that could be leading to marriage or a long-term relationship. So that's the courtship. It's the period, let's give it its proper explanation. It's a period of development towards an intimate relationship or marriage.
Ooh.
It's a period of time when you really get to know one another and decide whether you want to go ahead and get married.
Maybe in American English, they might say first base.
First, that's something else. That's not courtship.
Oh, is that maybe that's making advances towards having a sexual relationship?
Well, yes, there's yes, that's a phrase that men use towards women. First base, I think, is when you have a kiss.
Well, I think you'll find women will use that as well. I don't think
they
it's exclusive
do, yes.
exclusive to men.
I think first base means a kiss, doesn't it? Or
okay.
Something. Second base is you go a bit, you know. But that's not courtship. Is about getting to know somebody over a long period of time to see whether you're compatible for getting married, really.
So what do you think the right amount of time is, Steve, to get to know someone?
Well, the average time, actually it's interesting you should ask that, because in the UK, the average period of time of courtship is between 2 to 3 years.
Wow.
Apparently.
That's long.
I know, it's longer than I thought. So if you question a lot of married couples to ask how long were you courting before you got married, it's 2 to 3 years for them to make up their mind as to whether they think that's the average. Of course, some people love at first sight, they want to get married straight away. But traditionally, of course, the man woos the woman. Wooing or courting are their interchangeable words. And it's really up to the man traditionally, not so much these days, but traditionally, the man has to persuade the woman that he's going to make a good husband by proving that he's got a good job, he's got a good character, his parents, you know, he comes from a good stock, meaning that his genes are good.
It almost sounds like you're talking about an animal.
No, but that's tradition. That's going on with both parties subconsciously as well. A lot of that, because really a woman is looking for a man and a man's looking for a woman. They're both getting together really ultimately because they're going to have children and pass on the genes.
Oh, okay.
That's the whole point of it. So a lot of things are happening at a level which you can't necessarily put into words. And so courtship is part of that, because really if two people are going to get married and they're going to have children, certainly the both parties, that the woman particularly, has got to be sure that the man is going to be able to provide for her and the children for long enough for those children to grow up and then become adults and have their own children.
Yes,
that's ultimately what it's about.
Yes, I think because we did touch on this last week when we were on live on Wednesday. We talked a little bit about this because we were talking about the wedding that we were going to go to. Now we've been to the wedding.
Yes.
So today we're talking about words associated with that. So can you show us another word?
I can. So that's courtship. So you've been courting somebody, wooing them for a period of time, 2 to 3 years are the average in the UK. And then of course you might then propose to them. Get on one knee, on bended knee, with an engagement ring, and say to your loved one, will you marry me? So that's the proposal. But another phrase for that is pop the question.
I like that.
Pop the question, i.e. you ask somebody to marry you. Oh, When's he going to pop the question, do you think?
Yes.
Is the friends of a girl might say she's been dating or courting somebody for a long period of time. Oh, when's he going to pop the question? Meaning, when's he going to propose?
Because pop is kind of like letting something out. So
yes.
To pop the question is to ask the question, to put the question forward. You pop the question. Will you marry me?
Yes.
Will you marry me? Would you like to marry me? I am proposing marriage to you. I want to marry you. So I am asking you to marry. I want to marry you. I want you to marry me and me to marry you. We marry each other. Yes, I think that sounds...
Propose.
Propose.
So on one knee, the ring, propose. But used outside that context with friends, you would say, you know, something like, I don't think, is he ever going to pop the question? Is he going to pop the question?
Yes, he might pop the question tonight.
Yes, now, exactly, because you can probably feel it, it's coming on.
Yeah.
there we go.
It certainly is coming on.
So they've popped the question.
One thing I wanted to ask before we move on, traditionally, the man would ask the woman.
Traditionally, yes.
But nowadays, sometimes the woman will ask the man. So the woman will propose to the man. I know it doesn't happen all the time before people complain, but yes, I think it does happen. Yes. So I think sometimes a woman can actually propose marriage to the man.
That definitely can happen. Although I think traditionally it's still the man who is expected to propose. It's certainly, yeah, I think so.
Unless, of course, it's a lesbian couple.
Yes, I don't know what would happen then. There we go. Right, so we'll come on to that later. And then once you're once you've accepted that proposal, then the man you're engaged to becomes your fiance.
Oh.
So that's the man becomes the fiance. There's a little accent over there because it's a French word.
Fiance.
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 So that's the man. If the woman, this is the female equivalent. It's pronounced exactly the same. Fiance. So say I was getting married to a woman, I would say that was my fiance. And if I was to write that down, it would have the extra E on the end. If I was a girl describing my husband-to-be, I would describe them as a fiancé with one E. I didn't realize there was the female and male equivalent. They're pronounced exactly the same. One has an extra E.
So the pronunciation, maybe you just extend the actual E a little bit. So you say, this is my fiancé.
No, it's pronounced the same.
Oh. That's interesting.
Just got an extra E, I believe.
Yes, because of course in French you do have a very strong rule as to sort of the use of feminine words and masculine words.
That's it.
So maybe that spelling difference just denotes that one is for female and one is for male.
I think that's it exactly, Mr. Duncan.
Ooh.
So here's an old-fashioned word that also is related to proposal or in being engaged. It's betrothed.
I love this word.
Betrothed. And you do still see that.
It sounds like something from another time.
You do. So your betrothed is the person that you're engaged to. So that will cover fiancé as well. So it's basically the same thing. So betrothed. My betrothed is the person you're engaged to.
So the person you will eventually marry them.
That's
right. They are your fiancé, or betrothed.
You can say we are betrothed. So there could be two people talking and they're going to get married and they might say, oh, we are betrothed. Would be the same as we are engaged.
Hmm.
Comes from the old word troth, T-R-O-T-H, which means faithfulness.
Ah.
Being faithful. So that word is alluding to you are going to stay faithful with this person because you're going to get married.
Now I can see why that word is not so popular now.
Yes.
Faithfulness.
But you do still see it. You will see that written in a newspaper. Such and such are betrothed. Sometimes they'll write it that way in a formal way. So they're not married yet. But they tend to have some celebrations beforehand. And the men will get together to have a bachelor party.
Yeah, I like that.
A bachelor party, or in the US you would call it a stag do.
And I suppose it's
stag do.
It's also worth mentioning the word bachelor.
Bachelor, yes, which means a single man, a man who isn't married yet, a bachelor. And so what happens is you have a party. All his friends, all his male friends, will go out for the night somewhere, or usually these quite often for a weekend, just the male friends, and it's really his last chance to be sort of free before he gets married. So everyone gets drunk, basically. It's a drunken party, and sometimes they go away for the weekend somewhere as well and stay away, and it's his last chance to be a single man.
You know, there is a series of movies that are so funny. I'm going to mention them now. You haven't seen them, Steve. I know you haven't watched them.
Okay.
I've watched two of them, and the movies are called The Hangover. So there's The Hangover 1, The Hangover 2, and The Hangover 3. And they are absolutely hilarious. They are so funny. And that is all about a party that takes place just before one of the characters, one of the friends in the film, gets married. But of course, right, everything goes a little awry. Everything gets out of hand. But very good films. We should watch those together sometimes, Steve, because they are really, really funny. A little rude in places, but The Hangover is a very funny movie, and they made three of them.
Right, I know, I haven't heard that. I'd like to watch those. Sounds interesting.
Yes, they're very funny.
The bachelor party, that's the last chance for the bachelor, the man who isn't married yet, to have a final fling, not necessarily with a woman, although that it's not unknown for that to happen, but certainly the men will all get very drunk and they'll be ribbing him and joking with him and saying, your single life is over. It's time now to be ruled by your wife. You won't be able to go out and do what you like anymore because you'll be living with somebody else, your new wife. So this is the end of one life and the beginning of the married life.
You are no longer free.
You are no longer free. The women's equivalent to that, and in the US they call the bachelor party a stag do, but that word that phrase is used a lot in the UK now, a stag night.
It's kind of become universal now. So we say a stag party or a stag do.
Yes.
And do is another word for party or a celebration. You have a party or a celebration. You have a do. And it's spelt like the word to do, D-O.
So when the women get together, and they sometimes do that as well, it's called a hen night or a hen do. So that is exactly the same. The unmarried woman will get together with all her friends, some of which may be married, some might not be, and they will have a party as well. And I think, well, certainly in the UK, a lot of them will have a lot to drink as well. But it might not be about that. I think it might be they might be advising them. Certainly traditionally they would be maybe explaining to them what to expect in their married life with a man. You know, maybe they've inexperienced, maybe they're virgins, maybe the woman is a virgin, and maybe the women are going to explain to her what to expect in a married life these days. Of course, I keep saying the phrase these days there aren't many women that get married, certainly in the UK and the US, who are still virgins. But if they're very religious, of course they probably are, and that tradition is very much held in certain parts of the world and in certain cultures.
Yes.
So that's when some of the married women might explain a few facts to the women. Right, so we're building up to the wedding day. The wedding day, another word, another phrase that's used for the wedding day is the big day. So when's the big day? So two people have got engaged. The next question that will often be asked, and the phrase that often their friends will ask them, is when is the big day?
So,
and that means when is the wedding day?
So the big day. The big day is a euphemism for the actual wedding.
The wedding, yeah, exactly.
The big day. When is your wedding day? When is the big day?
Or when are you ready for the big day? In other words, have you made all the preparations? Have you made all the arrangements? Because there's an awful lot to arrange for a marriage, on the marriage day, for it all to go very smoothly. You've got to invite everybody, you've got to get a minister, you've got to hire a church, somewhere to have the reception, print out all the invites. There's so much to do. It's a very stressful event for people, so that's why they call it the big day. Anyone, lots of people watching us today will be married and they'll know what that's like. Right, so here's another word, nuptials. Now, I thought this meant something else, but when I looked it up, in fact, it just means forthcoming marriage ceremony and celebrations.
Yes, because a lot of people,
nuptials,
a lot of people actually think that means the sexual side of after the wedding. So a lot of people believe it, I'll be honest with you, I always thought that. So I always thought the nuptials meant what happens after the wedding, when the couple are together.
I think it can do, but it means the whole thing. It means the whole wedding day, the ceremony, everything connected with it, the nuptials. The nuptials will take place in London, for example. That just means that the whole ceremony, the whole marriage day, everything's going to take place in London or wherever. So that was an interesting, we know this one, bride and bridegroom. The bride, of course, is the woman, bridegroom, or often just shortened to groom.
Yes. So the bride is the lady getting married.
And the bridegroom is the man. So that's, you don't become a bride until your wedding day, or a bridegroom. So you will be called these terms on the wedding day, but also afterwards as well. You can be, after you've been married, for the rest of that. I don't know when that stops, so certainly for the rest of that day.
But before, though, don't forget you can say bride to be.
Yes, you can say bride to be, but on the day it's bride and bridegroom. And that can also be somebody who is recently married. You can still call them the bride and the bridegroom. But obviously, over a period of time, you wouldn't say that. But yes, you're right, bride-to-be or bridegroom-to-be. We're rattling through these now. The next one is best man.
Oh.
Best man. So in certainly in the UK and the US, this is a male friend who has special responsibilities during the marriage. He's looking after the groom, looking after the bridegroom, and he has special responsibilities. For example, witnessing, signing the register, the legal documents, and also he has to traditionally give a speech after the wedding has taken place, and during the reception he will make a speech where he will traditionally make fun of the bridegroom, tell lots of jokes, maybe very risky jokes, and maybe tell stories to the guests that maybe that the bridegroom wouldn't want them to hear about.
Embarrassing stories. Yes.
And usually by this stage the best man has had too many to drink, and it can get a bit raucous. And it can get a bit out of hand.
Especially when there's lots of drink being consumed.
Yes. You would usually choose your best man to be somebody who is, you doesn't have to be your best friend, but if you've got a best friend and you don't choose him as your best man, he might get upset. It's got to be somebody who's got a bit of a sense of responsibility, usually, but you usually choose your best friend. Interestingly enough, in the wedding we went to, the best man there He said this was his third marriage where he was the best man, so he must be very reliable and a person to have as your best man.
So he literally is the best man.
It literally is. He's the, well, or your best friend, really, the best man. So he has to give a speech and has certain he stands by the groom and hands him the ring during the ceremony.
There's one thing, Steve, I've noticed here is the wedding ceremony is very much dominated by the male.
It is. That's the tradition. That's the way it's always been. I think less so in other cultures, but certainly in the UK and America.
Yes,
it is very much dominated because the other speech, because the bride's father gives the bride away. But it isn't the mother of the bride that gives the bride away, it's the father.
Yes.
But you can have, of course, and the best man gives a speech, the father of the bride gives a speech as well, but the mother doesn't. But you also can have the matron of honor. Or in America you call this the maid of honor. So you do have, she's like the head bridesmaid. So you've got bridesmaids who are the sort of female helpers to the bride, who come from her family and her friends. And they're usually unmarried women. Traditionally, they would be unmarried girls, but they are probably of marriageable age. So this is an opportunity for maybe sisters of the bride and younger friends to be shown off to a lot of people, and maybe they will meet somebody at the wedding who may want to marry them.
When my older sister got married, I was one of the bridesmaids.
You were a bridesmaid.
It's true. I insisted on it. So there was me and my younger sister. So my elder sister got married, and myself and my younger sister, we were both bridesmaids.
But wouldn't you be the page boy?
No, I was the bridesmaid. I insisted on it.
Were you in a? You didn't wear a dress.
I had a lovely, lovely frock.
You didn't really.
It was pink, with little frills around the edge, and I always remember I had a big pink bow in my hair.
You're joking.
Very nice.
You are joking, Mr. Duncan.
I've still got it somewhere. I might wear it next week.
I think he's joking, viewers. I don't think he was a bridesmaid. If you have boys that help out at a wedding, then you call them page boys. But he's been quite serious. But so the bridesmaids, and the sort of head bridesmaid is the maid of honor. Matron of honor. If they're a matron of honor, it means they're married. Mm-hmm. If it's a maid of honor, it means they're unmarried.
Okay, we better move on.
So it's similar to the best man, but they don't give a speech.
That's it.
So that's that. We're moving on. We've done best man. So you come to, so you're married, you've had the ceremony, and traditionally then they would drive off in the car and go off on their honeymoon. On the same day.
You're missing something out though, surely.
What am I missing?
You're missing the reception.
Well, reception, yes.
The reception after the wedding ceremony. We mentioned this earlier, I know, but where is it? Where's that little bit of video footage? I've got a little bit of video footage. So, yes, here it is. So there's a reception taking place.
That's a reception.
That's after the wedding ceremony.
After the wedding ceremony. Everyone has a nice slap-up meal. A slap-up meal. That means a lovely meal that everybody enjoys. And then they traditionally then, after that ceremony is finished, they will go off in their car off to their honeymoon, which is obviously the holiday after the wedding.
Ooh.
But I don't think very often, certainly when my sister and her husband got married, they literally did. We had the marriage, the reception, and then on the same day, late in the afternoon, they drove off in their car and went off on holiday on their honeymoon.
That's it.
But quite often now that doesn't happen on the same day. The honeymoon might not take place for some time afterwards.
Yes.
Because they already know each other anyway, and might already have been living together for some time. And of course, traditionally on the honeymoon, if both both people in the marriage were virgins, that's when they would consummate the marriage. Oh,
they have sexy time.
Exactly, that's when that would usually take place. Of course, probably it never did. I don't know how many people ever, but certainly that a lot of the women would have been virgins, certainly, because in they would have been protected by their mothers up right up to the point where they got married. But maybe the men weren't necessarily. I think they'd probably, you know, got a bit of experience before the marriage. But let's not go into that.
I think it's too late now. I think we have gone
too late
into it.
Let's talk about one other thing now: same-sex marriage, which is something that is relatively recent.
Well,
relatively recent. Same-sex marriage or gay marriage.
It depends where you are in the world.
Depends where you are in the world. This is where marriages of same-sex couples and opposite-sex couples have the same rights, legally equal. It means that you can inherit, legally inherit. If the one partner dies, then that could be passed on. It's just so it's began civil rights for this began, if you look at the history of it, in the USA in the 1970s, but it was Denmark in 1989 that had the first legislation for registering same-sex partners or marriage. So having the same civil rights as marriage couples. But in fact, in the Netherlands, in 2000, it was at the turn of the last century that we had the first law. The first laws were passed for same-sex marriage, so all the rights exactly the same for same-sex and opposite-sex marriages as well.
Of course, still in many countries, same-sex marriages or same-sex unions, because quite often, even here in the UK, it's still seen as is legal. It is just something that gives you the same rights as someone who is married. So a man and a woman married, so a male, female married, male, married, female, married. They all have the same rights.
All have the same rights.
Legal rights, basically.
That's right. Well, yeah, exactly. About around 26 countries around the world now, same-sex marriages are in place.
And of course, the latest one was Australia.
The latest one was Australia. They're hoping to do it in Ireland soon, I believe, or no, they voted it out there, I think. I can't remember, but yes, it gives gay people the same rights. Incidentally, I saw a very interesting statistic because suicide rates amongst young gay people is quite high.
Okay.
But in countries where they did a huge study in the USA in states where they've introduced same-sex marriage, and the suicide rate amongst young males in particular dropped by something like 20%, because obviously then it's seen as part of society. It brings people into part of society and feeling that it's all right after all.
Well, yes, it's if you live with the whole of society not accepting you, then the pressure is already there, isn't it?
Exactly. So this is one step further towards the acceptance of.
And many countries now are realizing that it's no big deal. In fact, to be honest, it's not even a big deal.
Yes, the biggest barrier to same-sex marriage, of course, is religion. A lot of people were against same-sex marriage for many years because they believed that it would promote homosexuality. Of course, that's been just completely disproved. And also it would be bad for children. That's been disproved. And also particularly people from religious background think it's unnatural or shouldn't be done. We're not going to get into that.
We're not going to get into it. I'm going to talk about it for 10 minutes, but we're not going to get into it.
Well, it's we need to mention it. It's happening. It's happening now. It could be happening in your country right now.
That's no problem.
You may be for or against it, but we're not going to debate the for and against. We're just mentioning it as something that happens.
What's strange is no one is debating it. Most people are agreeing. So Robert says about the same-sex marriage, what do you say when introducing the other? This is my wife. This is my husband. Well, of course, partner. Partner. So
partner.
You don't have to say husband or wife. There's no need to do that. So because they can work that out for themselves. So your partner is just the other person who is involved in the relationship.
Although, interestingly enough, you can use the word wife. If two men get married, one might call his partner the wife. That my wife. That depends on the nature of the relationship.
Yeah, but it's often done in a sort of light-hearted way. Yes, let's not muddy things. We're making it muddy now. Yes. You can say partner. Partner is the accepted term. Yes. Not husband and wife, because it gets all a bit silly and messy and no one really knows what to say. So partner is fine. Partner. This is my partner. So there we go.
Of course, the other controversial thing is do same-sex couples get married in a church? That depends on the church. Of course, if you're sticking absolutely to tradition, the point of a marriage in a church is that two people. I've got to be careful what I say here, haven't I?
Well, it's a religious
into trouble.
No, wait,
it's a religious ceremony.
Well, getting marriage. There's no point worrying about what to say. You know, nobody's going to come around and drag us down the road. The thing is, that's what it is. It is what it is. That's it. A wedding is seen as something that's a religious ceremony. But nowadays, many people don't get married in churches.
Exactly.
So over the years, everything has changed.
Yes. So even same-sex couples, even opposite-sex couples aren't necessarily getting married in a church anyway.
Yes, that's the point I'm making. I'm making the point that it doesn't actually matter anymore.
No one
really goes to church in this country. No one is devoutly religious under the age of 30. So people getting married now are just going, let's just have the service, let's just have the thing at the register office. They just sign the paper, have a couple of drinks, and that's it.
Yeah, and some people do. Yeah, they do.
Yeah, see? So it's not really a big problem. It's not really.
No.
Some people have a problem because they have a problem. That's it. Basically.
Yes. Let's have a look at the chat, Mr. Duncan?
Wait there, I'm just getting rid of...
Oh, it's 5:04.
It's 5:04. This has been a very, very interesting conversation.
We haven't said very much. We haven't really looked at the comments. And I love to look at the comments.
We have. We've been talking to the live chatters. At the Oscars, there was a woman receiving her Oscar and she said something like, "This is to my wife." Yes, again. You're making a point there. So, but in general conversation, you don't always have to say husband and wife, because it does, as I said earlier, it does confuse things, because those involved in the relationship are the same. And that's the thing. That's the problem.
I think as well, for a lot of gay couples, it's still the romanticization of marriage. A lot of people, that there is this, that the whole... A lot of people love to get married because it's the ceremony itself and the whole everything around it is so romantic, and you are really making very powerful vows and statements during the marriage ceremony.
Yes, except they're not, because most people now, you know, they will have an open relationship or they get divorced later. So it's a ceremony, but I think much of the meaning now has become very hollow.
Well, I think for people who want to do that and still believe in it, that you know, that's why they're doing it.
You're just trying not to offend anyone.
No, I'm just saying it's easier, obviously, now. In the past, it was very difficult to get a divorce.
But
and so people really stuck it out.
Yes, I get that. Yes, even if the husband was smacking the wife around, she would stay with him. That's a great idea. Yeah, wonderful.
Well, interestingly, this is the order of service. I was going to just briefly mention some of the... this is a photocopy I've made.
Okay.
So it says there... I've taken the names out. Marriage order of service for the wedding of, well, it was John and Emma, we've already said.
Yes.
On this date and this church. And this then lays out the actual service itself. So it starts off with the bride coming into the bridal march. We said that on Wednesday. And then you get a welcome from the minister. And she usually says something along the lines of, "Dearly beloved, we are gathered here to witness the union of," and then she'll mention the names, "in marriage." Then they'll have an opening prayer. Then we'll have a hymn where the congregation will sing a hymn.
Mm-hmm.
These are traditional things which are said at every wedding. Then the minister will ask the audience something along the lines of, if anyone here feels that this couple should not be united in holy matrimony, speak now or forever hold your peace.
You do realize this is going to take as long as the wedding itself.
Oh, I'm doing it very quickly. So the minister will say that because legally they have to, because there's always a slight risk that one of the bride or the bridegroom might already be married to somebody else. And that's called bigamy. So you can't marry, not in this country, you can't be married to two people.
Yes. This is not the quick version, by the way.
No, that's fine. So there's always that phrase is said, and nobody ever says anything. It's a bit of a funny moment in a marriage ceremony, but it has to be said. And then there are declarations made
the vows.
There are declarations. Will you, the families and friends of, support and uphold them in their marriage now and for the years to come? And the congregation all says, "We will." So we're all there to help support them over the years, and we make vows ourselves. Then you get a sermon by the which is a bit of a speech, a bit of a to-do list really from the minister, telling the bride and bridegroom, you know, some words of wisdom on how to conduct their marriage. And then you get the vows where, do you take this man to be your wife? Do you take this man to be your husband? And do you take this lady to be your wife? For better or worse, in sickness and in health.
That's what he says.
To love and to
rapper?
Cherish.
Is he a rapper?
Death do you part? So that's quite often what is said,
You are really recreating the boredom of sitting through a wedding really well.
And then the minister will then say, "I now pronounce you man and wife. You may kiss the bride."
Oh.
There we go. So that's a quick version. That was an hour. And then the choir sings. They go off and sign the register and the choir sings. It's probably pretty much the same in all countries, or very similar, I would imagine.
Dear.
That was my little... We had these little placemats, didn't we, during the reception?
Yes, mine. I've already showed mine.
Oh, well, I'm showing my... Look what I had. I had beef. Oh, you've cut me off.
No, you... Wait there. You're coming back now. There's the garden.
On the back,
Steve.
It says what I'm eating. Beef, melon...
It's out of focus.
Oh, well, no one can read it.
Well, tell us.
Beef, melon... Beef... I start off with melon as a starter... God. Then beef was the main course, and then I had a chocolate brownie with ice cream afterwards.
A chocolate brownie?
It was delicious.
That sounds like an insult.
Can we have another look at the live chat, Mr. Duncan?
A chocolate brownie.
Everyone's still there. It was the most delicious chocolate brownie I've ever had in my life.
Dear me.
But you had fish instead of beef, didn't you, Mr. Duncan? You had fish instead of beef.
No.
No, you had beef. Sorry. You had soup instead of melon.
So... You were there, weren't you?
The starters, but you could have different starters, but we'd already pre-ordered beforehand. We'd pre-ordered the meal beforehand.
Yes, but I didn't have fish.
No, you didn't. But somebody next to me had fish.
Yeah.
But yeah.
You didn't notice that wasn't me.
But the starters, you could have soup or melon.
Was that my twin, was it?
You could have soup or melon as a starter. I had melon, you had soup.
Yeah.
You could have had, for the main course, you could have had beef, chicken, or fish. We both had beef, but somebody else had fish. And why anybody has fish when they go out, I don't know, because you can cook fish at home very easily.
Well, maybe they don't like eating meat.
Well, maybe they don't. No, they might be vegetarian or something.
Maybe they're a pescatarian.
Sure, what that is. As a sweet, of course, you could have had you had lemon tart.
I did.
And I had a chocolate brownie.
I like a nice tart now and again.
What's on the live chat, Mr. Duncan?
Goodness knows now. I think it's lots of people snoring after sitting.
They might be interested to know what happens in a wedding in England.
Oh, that was almost like in real time, though.
It wasn't.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, let's see if anybody thinks that. Was anybody bored stiff by it?
Well, for those that are still left.
I did sing in the wedding party to Jen. Unfortunately, we can't show the songs. Or did you? Have you shown any of the?
I haven't, because you don't know what's in copyright and what isn't.
Yeah, well, this is it. We don't know what songs were in copyright, so we daren't put them on in case Mr. Duncan gets blocked.
Yeah. Well, I don't get blocked. Somebody else just takes the ad revenue from my video. And
that's
not me.
It.
Yes. So that's the problem now. But I went to a lot of trouble last night to edit all of the music. And then Steve walks into the studio and says, oh, I think that might be in copyright. And then you didn't know what was in copyright and what wasn't. So in the end, all that work I'd done, I couldn't use any of it because I wasn't sure if it was, if I was able to put it on YouTube or not without getting copyright strikes.
Well, there was one that wasn't in copyright, but that was the one you decided you weren't going to record. So we couldn't show anything.
Yes.
All the hymns were in copyright. We couldn't show them, unfortunately.
So an hour of my work last night was a complete waste of time.
You could have asked me beforehand.
I wish I had. It would have saved a lot of trouble.
So have we got time to talk about uses for the word set?
Definitely not.
Now again we're gonna have to.
This is the sixth time that we've cancelled talking about the word set.
We are going to have to defer that to another time.
Even though you used it earlier.
Did I?
Yes, you used it earlier in the live stream. Of course, we are forgetting one group of people who are probably going to be very annoyed because we didn't mention them, and they are the people who don't want to get married.
Yes.
They want to stay single.
Stay single.
So let's not forget those. Let's not forget those.
What do you call them, Mr. Duncan?
Well, they're single. I think I just use that word. Single.
People who don't want to get married.
They are single people.
Yes, yeah, some people do choose to do that.
Single man, a single woman. They are single. They stay single. Yes. They stay single forever. Of course, a woman can also be called a spinster.
A spinster. That's an old-fashioned word.
Spinster.
That's not used anymore because it really. It's a bit of a derogatory term, really.
She's a spinster, an old spinster.
Yes, it means that the implication is that there was something wrong with her, which is why she didn't get married. So it's not a very nice term to use.
Hmm.
But of course, it was frowned upon if you didn't get married, and it still is in some cultures. Somebody from Indonesia told us on Wednesday that it's still frowned upon if you don't get married. In Indonesia, and I'm sure that's the case in many cultures.
Yes, in China as well. If you don't get married, if you are a male, especially a male, if you are a male and you are 25 and you haven't got married or you're not dating anyone, the family will probably have you put in a mental asylum. And I'm not joking about that. I wish I was joking. In the 1980s, people were still put into mental asylums for being single. Can you believe that?
Where?
In China.
Oh, right. Okay, blimey.
They viewed it as a mental disorder, not wanting to get married. And of course, there would also be the other things where they would think maybe you were gay as well. So again, you have all of these stigmas, these things that people assume, and things that are completely, a way of thinking that's completely unreasonable, and some might say hateful. So there.
Of course, marriage traditionally was for the whole purpose of it is to bring children into the world, and have a stable family unit to bring the children up. But of course that's not so vital now, because times have changed.
Yes.
And
well,
women can look after children on their own because there's lots of backup from the state.
Well, it was vital when civilization was uncivilized, when people used to just go up to each other and hit each other over the head with a rock. You know, that's when marriage was important, because it gave some stability. It gave some civility.
Which it definitely does do.
But of course, yes, but the human race now is civilized generally. So marriage has faded away. It isn't so important, because human beings are now more civilized towards each other.
Yes, in certain cultures and countries, it's not so important. So because certainly legally, if two people have been living together for a while, then they almost have the same rights as a married couple anyway.
Yes.
Yes, some people don't, but. You know, a lot of people like to go through that ceremony and commit themselves to one person for life. It's still a very romantic idea, and I think a lot of people would probably agree that would be a nice ideal to have in your life. It would be a lovely idea to feel as though you could be with one person that you love for the rest of your life.
Yes.
And have children, but of course life doesn't always work out that way. But it's still nice to have that as an ideal, as a goal, as a romantic vision.
You were really obsessed with a live chat, yet you're not saying anything to anyone.
Okay, what does blimey. One love said blimey. It's a bit like saying it's a bit of an expletive, isn't it, really?
Well, yes, you use it. Well, it's not an expletive.
No.
As a swear word. Blimey just means... I think it's based on the phrase blind me.
Blimey. What could I use instead of the word blimey? Good grief, or gracious.
Yes, blimey is an exclamation.
It's an exclamation meaning, yes. Oh, I'm surprised at that.
Yes. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my goodness.
Blimey.
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 Yes, that's how you would use that one.
Or if you're in London, you might say cor blimey. Cor blimey.
Yes, there we go.
Oh, YouTube's cut
Rabat
me off.
Said, yes, getting married is the most wonderful thing in the world, as long as your partner and everything is nice. But I think it's nice to have that goal, that ideal, to try and live to certain beliefs and certain standards sometimes. But yes.
Ah. Abril says, I don't believe in marriage. And Robert says, yes, very interesting this topic, thanks to our teachers. Oh, thank you very much. I did have thank a special you. Hello to give from TGN. TGN says, my daughter Elise loves you so much, and she asks if you can say hello. Hello, Elise. And also hello, I'm trying to get it back on the screen now. Oh, it's going so fast. TGN and also Elise, hello to you. We are going soon, because we have been here for such a long time.
Oh,
what?
Claire, don't say that about yourself.
Yeah, I don't think Claire is saying it about herself, actually. No. I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to do something here that I wish I'd done last week. Do, 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 do. Do, 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 do. Do. There we go. That's it. Done.
Aisel from Abidjan. Oh, I can't say it.
Abidjan. Go on. You can do it.
I need to see it spelt. I need to see it on the screen.
Abidjan.
That's it. I can't. Well, I've been talking too much. I can't talk anymore. Have we ever had anybody from Abidjan before?
I don't know. I don't even know where you're looking.
It was somewhere right at the end. Oh, keep going. Go back up a bit further. Somebody was from there, and I can't remember what that was going to answer what they were saying. Keep going back. Oh, I can't find it now.
Maybe it's disappeared.
No, I don't think so. Is it further back?
In Russia, married couples get divorced very often. Yes, divorce is something we haven't mentioned yet, Steve.
No, we haven't.
No, it's the opposite of marriage. So some people get married and then they realize that they don't like each other because they keep fighting and squabbling and arguing. And then they realize that they're not meant to be. They divorce. The opposite of marriage is divorce. So they decide to get divorced. My parents are divorced. Not a lot of people know this, but I've never mentioned it ever, but actually my parents divorced when I was in my late teens. So I was about 17 years old and my parents got divorced. I don't know why I sound so happy about it.
They did. But of course, traditionally, because you make these marriage vows and you say, for better or worse, in sickness and in health, till death do you part.
Yes.
A lot of people will see those, if they're very religious people, they will have said those words in a church in the eyes of God.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to take a lot for them to separate. And some people just stick together no That's matter it. What, because they believe.
I think I've already made this point. Yes, even if the husband smacks the wife and hits her and punches her, they stay together. But do you think that's right? Mm.
Well, I don't know.
Because you're worried that you might get punished. You might go to hell. So,
well, some people believe that.
Yes, that's it, you see.
And in fact, the last woman, we touched this before, the last woman to be executed in the UK, which was, I think, 1950-something. I can't remember when it was, 1950-something, I think it was.
I'm sure he said 1957.
I think it was then, but I can't remember exactly.
Okay.
It came out later on that she murdered her husband, but it turned out they used to beat her up.
Okay.
Allegedly.
Oh.
Now she'd have never gone to prison for that. But it used to be a big problem, and a lot of people used to get married, of course, and you can court someone for a long time, and you don't really know them because they're hiding their bad qualities from you because they want to marry you. So they hide their bad qualities, and as soon as they get married, all the bad stuff that they haven't revealed to you comes out.
Yes, over time.
So they might turn out that they're not very nice people at all.
It might turn out that they're really, really nasty and horrible. So yes, sometimes there is a good reason to get divorced, because maybe the husband is a rotten so-and-so. Maybe.
Or of course the woman can be hiding all sorts of traits that she doesn't want her husband to discover.
Yes, and well, you can have things like crimes of passion. A crime of passion is when someone in a relationship becomes jealous of the other person and maybe one kills the other.
Yes.
It happens both ways. So maybe the husband will kill the wife, or maybe the wife will kill the husband for many, many reasons. Maybe the husband is seeing another woman, or maybe the woman wants the man's money, so she makes sure that he dies in a certain way and then she gets all of his money. So there are many ways, there are many devious things, many unpleasant things that can happen in a relationship.
Oh, yes, but we don't want to end with that.
No, well, we're not ending just yet. I think we'll stay until 1:30, because we've been here for 2 hours and 25 minutes, so we may as well stay. We might as well stay for another 5 minutes.
In that case, I'll take a sip of water.
Oh, Mr. Steve is feeling very thirsty, I think.
I am. I've been talking a lot over this last hour and a half.
Happily, divorces exist. We all change so much with the years. I think so. How many types of marriage exist in your country, Mr. Duncan? Asks Atif. Well, when you talk about types of marriage, there is only one type of marriage, and that's where you get married to another person. So two people, they share a bond, and then they have it recorded legally. So a legal record of their marriage. And then, of course, they have rights. They have certain rights that only married couples can actually have. So Yes, there is only really one type of marriage, and that is the joining together of two people who are in love and want to spend the rest of their life together.
I suppose you could say that there are two types. There was opposite sex marriage and same sex marriage.
Oh, I see.
You might divide it into two like that.
Yes, so you can have a marriage between a man and a woman, or a marriage between a woman and a man.
Yes.
If you want to be awkward. Or, of course, you can have a marriage between a man and a man, or a marriage between a woman and a woman, and of course, yes, a marriage between a man and a horse.
Duncan,
what?
You're making that up. You're being silly now.
Haven't you heard of that, Steve? That's the latest one. That's the latest trend. Haven't you heard? You see, this is how far behind you are now, Mr. Steve. You're so far behind with all of this news. Yes, that's the next thing, apparently. They're bringing in marriage between a man and a horse. It's incredible.
What? You are joking, Mr.
I got
Duncan.
That. Yes, I got that straight from the horse's mouth.
I don't think you can legally marry an animal. You can, of course, leave your possessions to an animal in your will. I think you can do that. I think you can leave everything to your dog or your cat.
That's not really related to marriage, though.
No. So maybe two types, opposite sex and same sex marriage.
That's it.
Maybe two. Yes.
Oh, I see. I can see what's happening now. This is when it gets really complicated.
Oh, right.
So Saika asks, what about transgender? Oh my goodness, this is like a minefield.
That's
now.
A minefield.
I feel like I'm walking through a large minefield.
Well, transgender. Yes, I mean a transgender person is either going to be biologically male or female, so obviously they can marry, but there wouldn't be a separate classification for that marriage. It would just be two people getting married, because anyone can get married to anyone now. So you can two women can get married, two men can get married, a man and a woman can get married, as long as they're of legal age. So the transgender bit really isn't relevant, because they can get married anyway.
What I found quite shocking yesterday, I was watching a report on television, and they were talking about the age limit of marriage in the United States. And apparently children can still legally get married in certain parts of the USA.
I know, I was very surprised.
What is that
very
all
surprised.
About?
So you can get married to somebody, a girl can be married at 12. I couldn't believe this.
Yes.
Is this really true?
I don't know. Well, it was where did we see the report? It was on Russia Today, wasn't it?
Yes, maybe. Yeah. Is that, but is it true?
Yes, that's
it. Whether it actually, maybe, I don't know, because the legal age for marriage in this country is it 16? Or is it 18? I don't know what the legal marriage. I don't know what the legal age for marriage is in the UK. How strange is that? I think it's 16, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, I think all of the adult rights now pass when a person reaches 16.
But in some countries in Europe, I think the lowest I know of is 14. But I may be wrong there. I'm not sure. Can you legally get married? I can't remember in this country now. Someone will have to Google that and let us know.
Well, it's 16.
I'm sure it's 16. Yes.
If you're 16 or older,
yeah,
you can get married.
It's true. 16.
Yes,
but when we were growing up, it was 21. So when I was growing up, you can get married to 20. Then it went down to 18, and now it's 16.
Yes, but when we were growing up, many things were different.
Many things were different.
There are many things you couldn't do.
I'm having
things.
Another sip of water.
Oh yes, that's very interesting. I'm enjoying the running commentary.
Let's have a look at some more comments.
I'm now scratching my nose. I'm now pushing my glasses up. I'm now adjusting my hat. I'm now scratching my bum.
We don't want to know those sorts of habits.
You'd be surprised. This is the internet. Anything can happen on the internet, apparently. Gypsies can get married at a very young age, apparently, according to Simona.
Oh, right, okay.
Is that true? Gypsies can get married very young, at 11 or even younger. Is that in your country, though? Obaidullah says, in England and Wales, if you are under 18, you must have parental consent. Ah, yes, of course. Well, the parents must agree. Yes, of course. That makes perfect sense.
I think that's it. So I think you can have sex at 16.
Oh.
But you can't get married till you're 18, maybe. Unless you've got... I think, yes, it's strange. Of all the things we should have looked up before we came on to talk about marriage, it was that.
Yeah. Well, that's how things work. Well, I knew it was 16, but of course, until you're 18, you have to get parental.
Because there's a legal age for having sex and a legal age for being married.
Yes, yeah, so you've said.
I know. I'm just saying, and that's
starting to sound like.
Yes, it's. Now I can't read your name there. Are you Russian? Looks like an X. I see, Mr. Steve, you enjoy drinking vodka. I do. And this is what I need before I come on to do a live show with Mr. Duncan. It's pure vodka.
Is it really?
Yes. Are you Russian? I can't read your name. I have no idea how to pronounce your name there.
Oh, it is in Russian. Yes, you're right. I wish I could read Russian. Cyrillic. I'm not very good at Cyrillic. Oh, Mr. Steve, there's Mr. Steve. Look, he's popped up on my screen. Is he on your screen as well? Can you see Mr. Steve? There he is. Look, yeah, there he is, Mr. Steve. We'll be back on Wednesday, by the way. Just before we go, the mystery idioms, answers to the mystery idioms. So there is the first one. But what on earth is the meaning of that picture? Chatterbox. Ah, you see, chatterbox. It is a box that is chattering. The meaning, someone who will not stop talking. If someone enjoys engaging in conversation for long periods of time, like Mr. Steve, we might describe them as a chatterbox. Mr. Steve is a bit of a chatterbox. And the second mystery idiom.
Oh, well, that's an easy one. Even I can get that.
Can you get that, Mr. Steve?
Is it walking on eggshells?
It is. To walk on eggshells, which means...
To do some... I see, right. Okay, to walk on eggshells means to do something cautiously so as not to cause offence or create problems. You don't want to upset someone, so you must walk on eggshells.
Walk on eggshells, yes. So there they are, today's... Super duper 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 duper.
If you
duper.
Wanted to say something that was controversial to somebody or a touchy subject with somebody, you might be very careful the way you worded it. You would be said to be walking on eggshells.
You have to be careful what you say. You must walk on eggshells. Be very careful what you say.
If someone, for example, is very prone to getting upset, maybe about aspects of their appearance, so you might be very careful if they wore some new clothes, a new dress maybe, or had a new hairstyle. You might be very careful what you say, because they might react in a way that was unexpected or upsetting.
Mm-hmm.
So you would.
Anyway, it's time to go. It's a shame we haven't got time to go outside, but let's have a last look outside. There it is.
Oh, look, there's a squirrel.
There's a squirrel. Can you see the squirrel? He's looking for some nuts.
He won't find many there.
There aren't many nuts in the garden at the moment. Little squirrels.
Squirrels. Some people call them rats with tails.
Yes, I was talking about squirrels earlier. I actually started off today's live stream talking about squirrels because I was saying that they are a bit of a pain.
Well, they are classed in this country as vermin.
Yes, I'd mentioned that, and I said that people are allowed to actually kill them if they want.
And they are actually closely related to the rat.
Will the squirrel go up the tree? Let's see what happens. What do you think will happen? Do you think he'll go up the tree?
He will if I go out there. Shall I go out there and scare him off?
Oh, no, it's okay, Steve. Oh. It's all right. I wasn't planning on it being such a big performance.
I could do.
No.
I'll make him go up the tree.
No, he won't go up the tree. He'll just run through the fence. Can you see the hole in the fence at the top? There is a hole. What will the squirrel do? Will he go up the tree? See, I think he will. I think he's going to go up the tree in a moment.
He will if he gets scared.
Because he wants to have a look, you see, at what's happening around him. Go on, go up the tree, you stupid squirrel. Where's me gun? What kind of nuts grow in your garden? There aren't any nuts that grow in my garden, but sometimes I put nuts outside. I will put some peanuts outside. There are no butterflies yet. It is too early for butterflies. We're going now, Steve.
Oh!
Oh!
Time to go. Actually, I could do with a nice cup of tea and a cake.
We're going to have a cup of tea now. And tonight, what are we eating tonight?
Oh, it's Sunday night, so it's salmon.
I'm very excited.
Salmon with sweet potatoes, brown rice, and some tomatoes that I'll cook with the salmon. Yay. And a few peas and some spinach.
That sounds amazing. In fact, I think you should go and do it now.
Which reminds me, I've forgotten to get the fish out of the fridge because it's in the deep freeze.
It's still frozen.
It's in the deep freezer. So I'll have to get that out. But it'll be fine, a couple of hours.
Yes. I like my fish unfrozen.
It will be. I always overcook it anyway. Fish only takes really a few minutes to cook. I always cook it far too long.
Anyway, we're going now. Bye to everyone. Bye to Duong. Bye to Obadil Obaidula. Bye to Elo. Bye to Katrina Ute. Bye to you as well. Thanks for watching us. 2.5 hours we were here. Nearly 2 hours and 38 minutes. Can you believe it?
I tell you what we'd like to know is if anybody is getting married, anybody watching us, listening to us today, is going to get married, we would love to see or hear and pictures of their marriage ceremony. We'd be very happy to take that and then maybe show other people if you were willing to let us. Because of course we only really know about our own marriage ceremonies. I have been to a Muslim wedding and I've been to a Sikh wedding in the UK. I've never been to a Catholic wedding. They tend to go on for quite a long time, I think. But yes, so I have got experiences of other religions because I've got Muslim friends, I've got Sikh friends, and I've been invited to their marriages before. And very enjoyable. Different, but very enjoyable.
Yes, I bet the food is nice.
Oh, the food was gorgeous.
Yes.
I'll tell you the biggest difference I saw between a Muslim marriage and a Sikh marriage was that there was a lot of alcohol at the Sikh marriage ceremony, a lot of alcohol, which I won't say that whether that was good or bad, but the food in both was spectacular because, as you know, I love spicy curry food.
Yes.
Oh, so any invites to any weddings, then I'll always go.
Me too. So if you are getting married soon and you want to invite us to your wedding, please put us on the list of guests.
Please,
thank you very
do.
Much and we'll see what we can do. Anyway, we're going now, definitely.
Right,
thanks Steve.
Thank you, Mr. Duncan,
and we'll see you on Wednesday evening. Yes, we are back on Wednesday night, 10 p.m. UK time, for those who want to know when we are on.
I'll be dropping in a bit later.
There we go. Sunday 2 p.m. Wednesday 10 p.m. Both those are UK time. Don't forget UK time. You can catch all of this live stream later with subtitles, hopefully, because YouTube last week didn't give me the subtitles. I had to wait and wait and wait and wait for such a long time.
You did.
So we'll see what happens today. That's it, Steve. See you Wednesday.
We're all done.
That's it.
We're finished.
Catch you later, Steve.
Bye-bye.
That's Mr. Steve. He is now leaving the building. He's going outside to feed the birds and to chase the squirrels around because that's what he likes to do. I will see you on Wednesday. Yes, on Wednesday. Don't forget, once again, just very quickly, Wednesday, 10 p.m. UK time, late and live. This is Mr. Duncan in the birthplace of the English language saying thanks for following me, thanks for watching, for the past 2 hours and 44 minutes. I can't believe it. Really? Has it really been 2¾ hours? Incredible. And of course, you know what's coming next. Until Wednesday night. Ta-ta for now.